the U.S. So what is this? These are countries outside that are making information available to countries inside Africa. Now, let's just take the example of Kenya, because I think we have the highest number of Kenyans here. What are the countries that, if you could see all of the biodiversity research that's been done in Kenya, which country do you think would have the most Kenya data? Say it.
U.S.
U.S.? I would actually guess United Kingdom. Big colonial presence here, and the British Museum has specimens from the whole world. Okay, in fact, I'm quite certain of that because I've used thousands and thousands of Kenyan mammal specimens in the British Museum. But look at the UK contribution here in Kenya. It's quite small. This is digital accessible knowledge. Well, what's the break? It's not digital. The British Museum has a million specimens of birds. I couldn't find online any indication how much they have from Kenya. But it's very hard to tell unless your data are digital. Right? So what you're seeing in these pie diagrams is partly where the biodiversity data are. For example, for the DRC and Burundi, I suspect that's fairly true that most of the data out there are in Belgium. In this case, in these cases, I think what you're seeing are which countries are doing a good job of mobilizing their biodiversity information, not so much which countries have biodiversity information. So let's kind of get an overview. Biodiversity data, there's a wealth of data, and there's a huge poverty of data. Some taxa you can jump into right away, and other taxa are going to be very difficult. Some regions are going to be very feasible, and some of them will be very difficult. You have to seek collaboration and cooperation across institutions and across national boundaries. If you don't, it's not going to work. You're going to be working with partial information at best. But one last concept that I want to deal with about biodiversity information. Let's read about dragons. Dragon is a great lover of art, especially gold and silver work. He loves to hoard jewels and treasure, amassing vast amounts of valuable antique metalwork. Although they have any real use for money and jewels, they collect heaps of gold and gems. He, the dragon, is very jealous of his belongings and guards the treasure he's built up over the years in large storerooms. He keeps detailed inventories of all of his possessions. Does that sound familiar? So that he can be alerted immediately if a single object goes missing. So there's our dragon. But our biodiversity dragon doesn't sit on gold and jewels, but rather on specimens full of information, observations full of information. Keeps very good care of them. Never loses a single one, we would hope. But doesn't really have much of a use for them. You guys have a use for them. Okay? So what do we do about dragons? That's a hard one. Here are just two slides with ideas of steps forward. Certainly in the biggest picture, so this first slide is in the big picture, how do we change the big picture? Well, the most fundamental step is identifying major, significant, non-digital collections and get them digitized. They're not digital, they can't be shared. If they're not shared, they can't be analyzed. We can prioritize data improvement and data cleaning steps to maximize data utility and research. We need to open the access to the data to every extent possible. And basically, in this course, with this group of experts, that's been a given. Nobody's even talked about the argument. But it is enough. So that argument needs to be made clear. The data need to be made accessible universally. And last of all, the data need to be used. If the data aren't used, why go to all this trouble to digitize and improve and such? There's no good reason if it's just so that we know the data exists. So now let's be a little bit more specific, maybe to you guys. Okay? Again, 5-10 years in the future, the government of your country says, we want you to head up our national biodiversity inventory. What would you do? Imagine you had resources at your disposal, and imagine you had a group of people. What would you do? So a first step is to go out and look at what exists. That's the digital accessible knowledge. That gives you a lot of initial information. It provides you with some initial success and forward motion. It also allows you to see a way forward. Right? You may be able to guide your future steps by what you already know. That would seem logical. You need to then assess what exists worldwide. So you essentially have to say, okay, for my effort, for my region, for my challenge, that institution have large data stores. Now, how do I establish that cooperation to gain access to them? So, those are the first two steps. And then after those first two steps, or in tandem with those first two steps, we can imagine you sending out teams of people to gather new knowledge. You know, new field surveys, new inventories. But if you don't know what's been done already, you may misspend those resources rather seriously. Maybe you end up going back to a site that's already well characterized. So, that's simply the idea of biodiversity information strategy. Essentially, if you want to continue in this field, if you want to take on big questions in this field, this week you've seen a lot of interesting tools. Two of you stay on, and next week you'll see a different set of interesting tools. There are lots and lots of exciting things happening. Now the question is, how do you take all of that, the data, the tools, the people, how do you take all of that and put that together in a useful, informative picture of biodiversity? Okay? So, I'd love to entertain questions about this, and I hope that we can come back to these questions during the course of the day, because they kind of can also guide you in guiding the biodiversity informatics training curriculum as to what are the important topics and ideas to